Shalom, all praises to the Most High for another day and being able to finally make another video. I just wanted to share a few thoughts with you all briefly in this quick video regarding operating effectively in our roles as wives. In the previous video I did, I went through several scriptures, and just to refresh on that, it was Proverbs 31, Ephesians 5, 1 Peter chapter 3, and 1 Corinthians chapter 7. So you can check those out just to refresh on that topic. And one of the things that I knew before I got into the truth, but started to try to actualize, but didn't come to fully actualize until I was in the midst of marriage, was that the wife created for the husband and not the husband for the wife. That's a very profound concept. And in thought and in theory, of course, it makes perfect sense. But in operating in that and living in that, sometimes it takes some adjusting. And it definitely helps to go back to the scriptures to get more understanding of what that actually means. We were created for our husbands. We are the glory of our husbands, and we have a great duty to live out our righteousness, because it also affects him. You know, when you become one flesh, then what you do is a reflection of your husband, and what you do directly and can indirectly, but does directly affect him as well. As we press towards perfection, we have to actively become who we're supposed to be and not just remain who we've always been. There's going to be changes, you know, there's different levels of growth. And as you go through different situations, you know, and challenges in your marriage, you know, you guys face different obstacles and overcome those things, then the dynamics change, but the bond grow stronger and we're strengthened together. So it's always good to have a positive mindset as opposed to negative, that you guys are definitely a team, one flesh, and operate as such. So in the scriptures, when we look at Proverbs 31 and other places, in Proverbs and things like that, when it speaks of a virtuous woman, you know, you associate that with being something good or, you know, what have you. But it's actually a good focal point when you look into what virtue is and those attributes of a virtuous woman. So you can actualize that and walk that out in your life, live it out, live out the scripture. So, virtue is Hebrew number 24:28, and it is to aid, might, power, worthy, strength, strong, substance. And a soft Google search, the definition is respectability, dignity, high moral standards, purity, goodness, integrity, and worthiness. And we know for a fact, just seeing how things are out in the world now, that virtue is not something that is desirable among worldly people, among heathen people who reject the Most High. They don't seek virtue or to be virtuous. But we know that according to the word of the Most High, it is a good thing, it's a great attribute. And when you operate righteously in that and don't just do the bare minimal, you know, task associated with it, but when you truly put yourself into your role, then you excel, you know, and you also are able to set a standard, you know. Virtue is defined as having a high moral standard, which the scriptures help us to maintain. So that's virtue. And we know that as wives, in regard to our husband, we're the weaker vessel. And I know that some people think that that term weaker vessel is negative or derogatory or something strange like that. But that's not what that is, because you should research what these English words mean in the Hebrew to get a better understanding. Because weaker doesn't mean less value, because you already know, as we just looked into the Hebrew definition and even the, what is it? I think it was Webster's or something, just the soft search Google definition of virtue, that it's dignity, it's respectability, it's a high standard, purity, integrity. So you can't be less and be dignified. There's not dignity in less, you know, when you do it in that comparison. Less is when you putting someone on a lower level. It's a different level. You were created after the man, for the man. So there's not equal in the sense that we do the same thing. We don't do the same things. Men don't have babies. Okay? Men were told to love their wives. We're told to respect the men because we're nurturing in nature. It's natural for us to be loving, but we also have to be mindful of the respect aspect. Whereas men, you know, they'll provide and stuff like that, but they can be kind of rough. And it has to be in their mind to remember to love their wives, to actively do that. So the scripture is very clear on that. And we were not made to be, we are to serve our husbands. We are not servants like some peasant slave or something like that. So whatever the misconception is, go to the Greek number G772 and G4599 to get some understanding on that. Okay? Now, weaker vessel, according to those things, is more feeble and bodily vigor, because our frames are smaller and genuinely we're more less muscular than the men. In spiritual knowledge and power, and that is because the men are, in scripture, they're called the shepherds of the Most High. They are the teachers, they are the leaders. You know, they are the priests, and that's not to say that you're not supposed to study to show yourself approved, because absolutely you should study to show yourself approved. We all are supposed to. But when you have questions and you lack understanding, you know, you go to your husband. You don't start formulating your own ideas as to what the Most High said and things like that, because the Most High deals with them differently. We have different responsibilities. So let the man be the man and let him do the teaching. You do your studying and get, you know, have the knowledge there. Ask your questions to your husband, or if you don't have a husband, to your elder. And stay on one accord with the Spirit of the Most High. Don't go off into these weird doctrines, some weird doctrines out here. Please do not get caught up in that stuff, because it's crazy. And I don't even want to talk about it anymore. Alright, so in the definitions of what it truly means to be a weaker vessel, you know, your smaller frame, different responsibility, and regarding spiritual knowledge and power, if you even look at the Garden of Eden and how the serpent went to Eve first, as opposed to Adam, and I'm not going to expound all off on that because I want to get to the next part, so this video isn't really long, but there's a reason for that, okay? It was all intentional. as to why the serpent didn't just go to Adam and went to Eve first, and after she partook in it, then she was able to persuade her husband to do so. So it's not saying like all women are foolish or silly or whatever, but if you get a thought into your mind and you entertain it, then you can go off. That's why the man is the head to kind of keep you in line, so to speak, and keep you on that straight and narrow path so that you can make it into the kingdom. Alright? So, the next thing, after you understand your position according to scriptures and what it really means, as opposed to worldly meaning, it's important to maximize your day-to-day and prioritize and have your house in order. One of the most important things that I know from experience and in throughout the scriptures is prayer. Have a set aside prayer time and definitely get your communication through with the Most High. Make time for that and stick to that. Be true to that. Commit to that. Be faithful to that. All of those things. Meditate on the word, like it mentions in Psalm 1. And we talked about studying to show yourself approved, which is in 2 Timothy 2, verse 15-16. Keeping the home, that's important as far as maintaining a peaceful atmosphere. You want to stay on top of the cooking, cleaning. If you have to schedule, because, different households require different things, so you may have different appointments or, activities, stuff like that with the kids, with your husband, helping him to stay organized, you may need to schedule things. So I personally, I have a agenda calendar book, a monthly planner, that's what it is. I have a monthly planner, and I also make to-do lists. I'm the to-do list queen. I will to-do list everything. This was on my to-do list today, this video. So, just staying organized will definitely help you maximize your day-to-day. As far as cooking, I do meal prep, so I don't have to cook every single day. I just take a couple extra hours and cook on certain days so I don't have to spend as much time those other days doing that, and on the days I don't have to cook because the food is already prepared, then I, can do other things that need to be done. I can focus on that and really maximize my time doing those things. But breakfast, cook every morning. Other than that, I don't have to. So meal prep, I'm definitely a supporter of that. As far as mealtime, I suggest you eat together as much as possible. You, your husband, kids, if you have kids, spend those meals together. I like to eat with no TV on, but sometimes, my husband comes home, he wants to watch a movie just to like block out the day and just relax and unwind. So if that's his desire, then we'll do that. But we don't always do that every night. A lot of times we'll just talk, throughout dinner. That's where the talking goes on. You catch up with the day-to-day, find out what's going on and things like that. You can express any concerns and what have you. And then after that, if you want to watch a movie, you can watch the movie. I'll just probably still be talking. Still talk throughout the movie. Talk about the movie. We communicate well. So all praise to the Most High for that. We should eat together as much as possible. And be sure, to serve your husband. Serve him first. Make it nice. And do it as unto the Most High. Because I know sometimes it can start to feel like a chore, but it's not a chore if it's your responsibility. It's not. It's it's not so much a chore as much as it is your job. I hope the computer didn't ring a lot, but if it did, I'm sorry. It's your job. So look at it as your job, and you have your reward in heaven. So don't look, you know, for bragging, oh, I do this, I do, I cook all the meals and all the snacks and all this stuff. I mean, it's fine if you do that, you're stating that as a fact, but there's no need to brag on that. You know, you're doing what you're supposed to do, so congratulations for that. Keep it on. And do it well. Do it as unto the Most High. Don't look at it, you know, if your husband, if y'all are having a little tiff or something, and you're looking like, oh, I'm not going to cook for him, I'm not going to do this, or he needs to clean, or what have you. Be faithful in your part, and be blameless. Be found blameless in your part of the matter. Forget all the other stuff. And just be obedient above everything. Excuse me. Be obedient. Don't look for other people to do right before you do right. Because you set the tone as a woman for how the household continues to flow. You know, so you should be positive. You should be, you know, mindful of the scriptures. Be a teacher of good things to your children. And be a righteous encouragement to your husband. So, make sure, you know, you just stay on point. And if you have an off day, get back on that day, if you can. If it's the end of the day, then the next day. But, you know, it's very important for us to stay right. When it comes to family time, that's very important as well. You know, plan family activities. Family outings, you know, if you can, do family vacation. Engage as a family as often as you can. That way you know what's going on with the kids. The husband knows what's going on with the kids. And they see a united front as an example. They see their parents, you know, in a righteous marriage. And they can understand this is how it's supposed to be. Not all this mess I see on the TV, but, you know, parents, they at home with the kids, they're eating with the kids, they're talking to the kids, and listening to their kids, and helping them understand how to get through different issues, situations, and stuff like that. So, definitely important. And then also be mindful to make it, if you can, enjoyable for the husband as well, because a lot of times, you know, kitty stuff is kitty stuff. But, you know, as kids get older and stuff like that, he may take more interest if you include him and, you know, giving suggestions for what you can do for a family outing. Or, you know, it may be something that the husband wants to do that the whole family can do. So that'll be good, too. Make it enjoyable for everybody if possible. That'll be good. Spouse time. This is the time you connect with each other, so definitely appreciate it and take it seriously. We turn our phones off. I know some people might not be able to do that, you know, because of whatever the situation is, but if you can, turn your phone off, or at least turn it on and vibrate, especially if you have 5 million notifications coming in from the Facebook and YouTube and Instagram and all those other things. Cut it off, turn it down, whatever you have to do so you can focus on your spouse, give your undivided attention to your spouse and not be distracted. No TV unless that's what you guys are doing. If you're not watching a movie or watching a show or something like that, then cut the TV off. Get creative as to how to keep their attention and keep your husband captivated. I'm not going to go too much into that. I'm pretty sure you guys understand. And like I said, with all of these things, to do this can help. Calendars, reminders, notifications, all those things can help you. to stay organized as far as, you know, what needs to be done this day and all of that stuff. Because when I was younger, I used to be able to remember everything. Now, it's too much stuff. I have to write it down. And I have to remind myself, I have to remind him, I have to remind whoever else needs, you know, to be reminded of what needs to happen. So, just, you know, find what works for you. That's not for everybody. But even if you use your phone, the phone is not good for me. Writing it out is good for me. Because I'll leave the phone in another room, going about my business, and forget about conference call or prayer call or whatever. You know, somebody called, it's an emergency, trying to get in touch with me. I won't know. Because I'll leave that phone on the charger somewhere and going about my business. So, find what works for you and use that to schedule your family time and your spouse time. If you don't have an abundance of time, you'll have to schedule it. So just do what you gotta do. Make it work for you. You know, make it easy for you. Don't stress yourself out. Be a blessing to your husband. Always treat him well. Tell him verbally and show him through actions that you care for him and you desire him. You know, hug him, give him kisses. They like massages. Give them those. Your loving touch will help you connect with your spouse. So that's important. Just to, you know, touch, hold hands, things like that. And they don't always have to be the ones to initiate. You can initiate. I encourage you to initiate. You know, we come, my husband come in the door. If I'm not super tired, I run to him, hug him, kiss him, like he just, you know, came back from the war or something. it's a battle out there. So definitely, you know, love on your spouse. Don't be selfish. Okay. Learn him and accommodate his needs and desires. That's going to take you paying attention to him, listening to him, and then not being selfish and stubborn, but, you know, making an effort to do the things that he mentioned. So, that's important. That's important. Be beautiful for him inside and out. Take care of yourself. You know, keep yourself up, make an effort to live nice for him. Most importantly, stay scripturally sane. You know, it's a lot of things that can try to come in and throw stuff off. You stay scripturally sane. Your husband has something solid there that he can depend on. Like, be dependable, you know. Be a great, you know, source of strength for him, encouragement for him. You know what I'm saying? Pray on his behalf. You gotta lift those men up in prayer. Cook good, healthy things for him because you want him to live long. So, you know, we already shouldn't be eating no pork, lobster tail. Shrimp and all that other crazy stuff, but also, you know, look into, if you don't already, look into healthy meals, you know, even if it's just a side, try to get consistent with that, because you want him to live a long and prosperous life, healthy and vibrant. So, eat to live. I believe that. Don't live to eat, but eat to live. My husband makes a lot of vegan meals that he might not initially care for. I try to make them as good as I can, but I don't compromise the integrity of the food, so I'm not dumping all my just salt and butter and things like that. You know, I just tell him, you know, I want you to eat this because I want you, you know, to be here just as long as I'm here, not longer. So, do it. We had to get him off this little sidebar this cereal stuff, read what's in these cereals, okay? My husband's favorite cereal is that one, Reese's Puff. I think that's what it's called, Reese's Puff, Reese's Puffs, whatever. Y'all know what I'm talking about. It has butane in it. Butane. Why does cereal have butane? Butane. That's crazy. Don't feed your family. Don't do that. That's crazy. A lot of this research with TBHQ is. Okay? It's poison in these foods. So just keep that in mind while you're shopping and cooking and all this other stuff. Alright, on his preferences for things, there may be, and this is so, so minute, but it can turn into such a big thing when pride gets into the way. A perfect example, the way my husband likes to cook his eggs and his grits is not the same way I cook eggs and grits. I don't eat those things anymore, but when we first got married, I did. And I like mine, you know, to taste like grits. He likes to cook his until it's pretty much creamy. He likes a whole bunch of butter. I don't like a whole bunch of butter. I don't cook with salt. He loves salt, like, on everything. So it was just, you know, different. We had to compromise with the salt and butter thing. But as far as the methods for cooking, just do it the way he wants it done, or let him do it if you know, can't do it. But learn, make the effort to try. It's not that big of a deal. It's not so much that he thinks you can't cook or he doesn't appreciate it. He just likes it that way. You know? That's like, if you like baked chicken and he like fried chicken, then bake and fry some chicken. Stop it. It's just, you know, you don't have to do it all the time, but sometimes, you know, be considerate of the other person, especially if this man goes out and works hard and is doing his best to provide for his family. Let him have a couple pieces of fried chicken. I fried an avocado oil. You know, it's like, there's going to be some type of health benefit there as much as I can. It took him a long time to get that fried chicken. I'm not going to lie. So, you know, this is just as much for me as it is for everybody else. I'm just sharing my thoughts different, and you know, based on, like, different little things we've encountered so far. Encourage him and give him words of affirmation. Because your actions, of course, should show it, but sometimes they just need to hear it. So just, you know, say, you know, you're such a wonderful husband. I love you so much. I appreciate what you do. Thank you. You know, you're the best. Whatever you say. Do it and mean it. Be firm in rejecting advances from other men. I don't feel like that really needs to be expounded upon. What I will add is, even on social media, just be very careful with your interactions with other men, because you do not want your word to be spoken evil of. So just stay above the approach with that one. In this part, because I've seen many people stumble, fall, and fail on this next part, but this part I pray so much, you know, for our boys and stuff like that. Teach your children to love, honor, and respect their father. Show and explain to them how important he is, how he provides for the family, he worked so hard. You know, make sure they understand this stuff. Make sure you understand this stuff. He goes out, he works so hard, gives you so many BS, you know, to provide for the family. How giving and loving he is. Teach them to appreciate and value the time, you know, spent with them. They should value the father in the home. And even if he's not in the home, because I know some people have, you know, different situations and stuff, teach the kids to honor their parents. That's scripture, okay? So be sure to do that. And teach them to do nice and kind things for him. Even if it's just making like little cards, you know, little thank you notes or something like that. Make them snacks, bake, or, you know, get a cake or some cookies or something. Something like that. Just to show your appreciation. Or like little family pictures. You know what kids like to do. They like to paint. They like to draw. You know, even if they're older, they might be able to do, you know, something nice, be creative about it, and just so he feels appreciated from not just you, but from the children also, because that's important. I know it was one situation where, this was before I was in the church, it was a lady, and she was talking about Mother's Day and all that kind of stuff, and how she was going to do something for Father's Day too. And the conversation turned into, what are the kids going to do for the father? Like, she was the father of the mother. And she was like, oh, well, you know, they're going to call him, they're calling him, and all this other stuff. I'm like, what are you talking about? I don't feel anything like that. So, teach your children, that's part of your job too, teach your children how to appreciate and honor their fathers. Alright, and this last part, and I'm not going to be doing it way longer than the third one, is just in that downtime when your husband's kind of doing his thing, and you need to just let him do his thing. Just use that time to, you know, I don't want to say so much focus on yourself, but you are focusing on yourself in the sense that, you know, if you need to pamper yourself, use that time for that. Use it to do worthwhile things that are pleasing to the Most High. There's nothing wrong with, you know, taking care of yourself and making sure you are at peace and relaxed instead of running there getting inside. Go get one. I might join you, you know. But you can read in that time. You can study and research different things. You can exercise. You can, you know. So, I know, you know, my husband's watching his movies, or he might be, you know, doing his own little thing. I tried to get my sewing in. I took on the project. I had some paints that I had packed away, and I started transforming them into skirts, using the paints to make skirts. And I got about 5 out of it. I think I have 4 more left over. And I also, you know, took on the task of doing that for other young ladies too, because it does help with not having to spend extra money trying to revamp your wardrobe into a righteous wardrobe and stuff like that. So I find that was worthwhile. You like to write, you like to pull, you know, if you want to, with the permission of your husband, of course, connect with other righteous sisters. You guys can, you know, do something together. And just enjoy the quiet time. Yeah, I got a cup of tea. You know, when he was taking his nap or something like that, it was a day off, and I sit up there get my reading, and if it's something I want to catch up on, I do that. I had to learn how to kind of balance that, because initially when we first got married, we were all up in each other's face, no separation at all, but you know, as time went on, working, he had his work, I had my work, and you know, it was stressful. So when he had downtime, I was like, we need to spend it together, but he still needs his time too. I kind of decompress from the day that he had, you know. So while he was decompressing, I was doing whatever I, you know, wanted to catch up on doing, and then we would come back together and have our time and stuff like that. So it wasn't so much a problem, but it was an adjustment, because, you know, work, especially both work outside of the home, it can put strain sometimes on things. So that's why that spouse time is important. And when he, you know, takes time for himself, if you can use that time to do something for yourself, do that. You know? And don't take on the attitude of, oh, my life revolves around him, and, you know, everybody else. And, yeah, it kind of does. You know, if you read the scriptures, your life is dedicated to others. So those moments that you have for yourself, treasure those, because you don't get it. Some people, I don't get a whole lot. There's a whole lot of other things that need to be done, so I can't just sit back and say, oh, well, I'm just going to take this day and just do whatever I want. I don't have that option very often. So when I do, oh, I enjoy it. I really, really enjoy it. But usually, Shabbat is my best day. And even then, you know, still some stuff we have to buy. Make sure we got the mood done, the food prepared and everything. But it's just a matter of making this plate and stuff. That's it. That's all I have. If you have any questions, it's the first one in the comments, and most high willing, I'll be able to make another video. If not, tomorrow, the day after. I know I always say that, but you guys have to understand, it's not me. It's YouTube and all these internet providers. It would literally take me off, and I've made two videos before I made this video, and I could not get them to upload for nothing. And I was like almost done with it. I was like, forget this crap. Not crap, but out of frustration, I said crap, but I know it's not crap. But I was like, forget this, because it just seems like so much of a hassle. I don't feel like dealing with it. Like, I have so much other stuff going on. Yeah, feast of dedications, which, you know, I want to find out how you guys feast of dedications. Our anniversary came, you know, stuff like that. So, I had a lot of stuff I needed to focus on and prepare for. And it was just hectic. Trying to get these videos, you know, and I would end up deleting them, because it's like, who knows when they're going to go up. I made a before Feast of Dedications video, now it's after Feast of Dedications video. I'm not going to upload it. So, I'm done. Thank you. Most of them, everything is squared away and set now, and perfectly stays there. so that I can come to the end of my day and ability. Until then.